Hello and welcome to a VC Circle podcast. My name is Narinder Kapoor, and today we're going to talk about the first private financial company so far undergoing bankruptcy proceedings. Dewan Housing Finance Limited is an NBFC that has debt worth over 1 lakh crore that it owes to its creditors, who include mutual and pension funds, banks, insurance firms, and retail investors. Financial creditors are alone owed 87,000 crore. With me to discuss the latest and very highly public developments in the matter is VC Circle Special Correspondent Beena Parmar. Beena, thanks for joining in with us today.
Thank you, Narinder. Hello, everybody.
So, could you provide a bit of background here? Can we get a bit of a glimpse into DHFL's past? What exactly brought about the reason for us doing this podcast today?
So quickly, to run through how this all started. The first it started was 2 years ago when the liquidity crisis hit the financial industry, and the crisis was led by the ILNFS collapse, which was in September 2018. Mm-hmm. A few months later, there were allegations surfaced against these promoters of DHFL, the Vadhavan Group, for diverting funds to shell companies in order to buy assets. And these firms, which were linked to the Vadhavan Group, Kapil and Dheeraj Vadhavan, they had made political donations beyond the mandated levels. So here we are talking about a company which was once India's top shadow lenders. And among the housing finance companies, this was the second largest private mortgage lender after HDFC Limited. So clearly it's a huge size company. And amid all these allegations and the cash crunch situation, in November last year, the Reserve Bank of India superseded the board of DHFL and appointed a 3-member body in order to advise the RBI-appointed administrator to undergo the whole, insolvency process of the company. Mm-hmm. Now, while an auditor report has denied misconduct, an investigative report by Grant Thornton India, it revealed that the firm used softwares to hide fraudulent transactions. And this has also now been reported by the administrator who's managing mm-hmm. the insolvency process. So in September this year, the administrator who is managing the insolvency process, they also filed a case of fraud worth ₹12,705 crore against the promoters Kapil and Dheeraj Vadhavan in the bankruptcy court. And these promoters are currently behind bars. And the resolution right now is being tracked by the government, by the regulator, entire business community, and also specifically the investor community to see how financial companies are being dealt with under the insolvency, as it's one of its kind after ILNFS.
So that all this started 2 years ago with the collapse of ILNFS, as you mentioned, and now we come to the present with DHFL. Things have gotten a little edgy, as we've been seeing in various reports over the past couple of weeks. Could you give us an idea about the latest developments here?
Correct. So under the IBC process a few months ago, we saw around four potential interested parties who could be bidders for the DHFL case, mm-hmm. the assets of DHFL, I mean. And these are Oak Tree Capital, Piramal Enterprises, SC Lohi, and the Adani Group. Now, there are four rounds of bidding that took place, and there were many revisions in offers bid by these entities. Now, we've seen the bid offer amount has risen by around 50% from the first bidding round. So clearly, a lot of progress has been made as far as getting the best value out of these entities. Mm-hmm. And as of now, Oak Tree is said to have made the highest bid, which is at 36,650 crore. Piramal is the second, which is at 35,550 crore. While Adani, which many have also alleged that it was a late entrant and should not be allowed and due process was not followed. But that issue has now been receded. So their bid currently stands at 33,100 crore. And that has been accepted, at least in the bid amount. And there's SC Lohi, which is a Hong Kong-based investor, which has also bid for a part of the assets, which is the Slum Rehabilitation Authority portfolio. It's a small portfolio, and that has been bid at 2,350 crore. Again, Adani has also bid for these assets, which is a little higher at around 2,700 crore. Now, SELOE has not revised its bid, so clearly SELOE is out of the race. Adani seems to be also out in the race as of now. So there are these two entities which still remain in terms of the fight to acquire DHFL.
But if I look at the bid amounts, you know, Oaktree at 36,650 crore, Piramal at 35,550 crore, Oaktree is higher, not by much, but it is still higher. And in right. such situations, it's usually the highest bidder that wins. So what exactly is the bone of contention going on here?
Correct. So while Oaktree's bid is higher, the question before the administrator at present is that which offer is more sustainable? Remember, the IBC, the law, was ideated in order to bring out value maximization when a resolution is taking place. So right now, the fight here is between the top two bidders, Piramal and Oaktree. And Adani may mostly not revise a bid. I mean, there is unlikely that there will be another round of bidding. Mm-hmm. So currently, both these entities who are fighting it out have written to the lenders. And while the lenders have been tight-lipped, mind you, during the entire bidding process, you know, they've not been talking to the media. They've remained low-key. And both these entities have written to the lenders, putting up their case on why their bid should be considered. They've made presentations before the Committee of Creditors. And the Committee of Creditors, by the way, begin to vote today, that is December 24th, to finalize the winner. And this will be done over the next few days. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about, their points that they have made before the lenders, on our off-record conversations with Piramal and Oaktree, what Piramal camp has been saying is that Oaktree's bid is conditional and Piramal's bid is quantitatively as well as qualitatively more superior, as even their upfront payment is 1,000 crore higher than that of Oaktree's. At this point, Oaktree said that Piramal's upfront payment offer was made at the last stage, which was in violation of rules. Now, Piramal's side, they also say that their plan is more implementable. Now, we know that, it's an Indian company. Piramal has a better say. They have, better influence in terms of talking to, I should not say influence, but they are more well-versed with the whole Indian business aspect. While Oaktree is a foreign entity, mm-hmm. One of the major hurdles Oaktree could face is that it's a regulatory hurdle, that because they cannot purchase the insurance arm of DHFL. Now, there is Pramerica Life, which owns 49% in Oaktree. In DHFL's insurance arm. And if Oaktree has to buy this insurance arm, it cannot, as of now, given the regulatory norms, where a foreign entity can hold only 49%. So we don't know how the IRDA will allow this. Even then, Oaktree has promised to pay 1,000 crore for the insurance arm, while Piramal mm-hmm. has offered to pay 200 crore. Even though that's a low offer, we would not know whether their purchase or their acquisition for the insurance arm would be permitted at all. So that is, of course, a regulatory bottleneck that Oaktree might face. There's another point where retail fixed deposit holders, now we know that retail investors usually face the steep haircut in any acquisition. In this case, Piramal said that they have assured to distribute 10% more over and above what is allocated, what would be allocated from the final recovery by the lenders to these retail FD holders. Mm-hmm. So here they have promised, because, they would also want the clients, they want to start a new business, Piramal, so they would want to sustain that business going forward and keep the clientele going. One other advantage that Piramal has is that they are a strategic investor. They know how to run a business, while mm-hmm. Oaktree, as we know, is a financial investor. Their focus is completely different. When we talk about the Oaktree side, they say that the process has been discriminatory against them. And they are claiming that Piramal has been using unfair tactics to compete with Oaktree, saying that their upfront payment is much more. But Oaktree believes that upfront payment is similar and they have, bypassed the rules. Mm-hmm. Oaktree also claims that their net present value of the total recovery that the lenders would get is around 1,500 crore rupees higher. Oak Tree, as I said, you know, they also claim that, you know, the revised bids were actually called out by the COC to weed out the non-compliances. But in those, in that round of bidding, Piramal did not stick to the rules and changed the commercials by increasing the upfront payments. So they say that the rules were not followed. They also matched the insurance business amount of 1,000 crore that Oak Tree was offering. So Oak Tree's apprehensions, they say, are not unfounded. And Piramal, you know, is already under stress. We know that they're talking to a lot of investors to save their business. This could definitely be a good deal for Piramal to take the offer. So, you know, these two entities are now fighting it out. Let's see what happens.
So for both sides, then, what will be the implications of this deal?
Well, as I said, for Piramal, this is the best deal to kickstart their consumer finance arm because they are setting it up right now. They've already appointed a new head from Axis Bank. And, you know, for Oak Tree, it would be a positive when it comes to, you know, the foreign investors who are actually keen on buying distressed assets. They are in the wait and watch mode on how the insolvency law turns out for investors. So this would definitely bring in more confidence for the foreign investors. From a lender's perspective, you know, not much time is left to close for this year end before the whole deal. The deal procedures, even after finalizing, would take some time. And lenders really need to recover. You know, their bad loans are piling up. They are seeing a lot of resolutions being stuck at various stages of insolvency, outside insolvency. So they would definitely want to clear this and get a large recovery in hand this year, this financial year itself. So, you know, a large recovery, they would not want to slip away. So they would want to finalize this. The RBI has pushed this asset into IBC as an exception. So they would also want to set a precedent to other financial firms or even other non-financial firms to show that this law is actually working and resolutions going forward would be based on such cases. So we'll have to probably wait and watch as to how this turns out, you know, who gets the final bid, who wins the final bid, and who takes the cake in the new year.
And then we shall have to have you on again to talk us through this final decision that does take place. But for now, Peena, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Narinder. It was nice to explain. And we'll definitely watch out for the developments later.
So as always, you can find more information regarding this story and other matters in India's PE and VC space by going to vccircle.com. Thank you. Stay safe and happy holidays.
Happy holidays, everybody.